Good morning and welcome to Trinity United Methodist Church and the broadcast of our worship service for May 24th, 2020. We are glad for our whatever platform you are using to join us today, be it the radio, Facebook Live, the internet, through our website, or however you may choose to be here. We welcome you as part of our community of faith that is in diverse places all over the world today. I'm Joseph James, the pastor here, and I'm joined by a limited number of instrumentalists and choir folks that are here to help us with the worship of the Lord for this day. And the announcement that we have is that our Restart Task Force has been doing their work, and they continue to do it. This coming Wednesday night, they will make their recommendations for church council for how we shall proceed to open for our first worship service on June the 14th. And we will have more information out for you in the Trumpeteer article this week and also later in the week towards our other platforms, so that you know the steps that we are taking to keep you, the members and friends of Trinity, safe at this time. Wherever you may be this day, welcome, and will you please join us now for the worship of the Lord. for each of the past weeks that we have been worshiping in a dispersed fashion. I have offered this opening prayer, and again, I offer it this day. Will you bow with me? Thank you for your presence, O God, for the communion of saints, for those worshiping online, for one another, for this unique occasion. We know that nothing can separate us from your great love. In gratitude for that knowledge, we now gather, separate from one another, but united in you. In your holy name, amen. Now, will our children please be attentive for our children's time? Good morning, boys and girls. I'm glad that you're tuning in this morning. And I want to talk to you today about something that is not easy to talk about. It is something that makes people sad. It makes them hurt in their hearts and in their souls. And it's about death. I want to talk to you today about what happens when we die. And the first thing I want to tell you is that our soul, our spark of life, is like my hand. And when it has time, before we are born, it goes and it is with God and it rejoices and with God. And there comes a time when we are born. And we come into the world, and just like this glove, we come into the world, sometimes with a little bit of effort to put the glove on, but we come into the world, and our soul and our body are one, and we go through the world and do all kinds of things. We eat, and we're happy, and we do all the things that human bodies do. We love one another and care for one another. But there comes a time in our lives when our bodies start to break down, maybe because of an accident or a disease, but our body starts to slow down. And the function, the things that our heartbeat and our lungs begin to stop. And what happens when we die is that we shed our body. Our glove is like our body. And we bury it in the ground. But our spirit is no longer part of our body. And it goes and it's free from all the pain and all of the suffering that we had in those last moments of life. And our spirit goes and it rises and it goes back to God who made us, who loves us. Death is very sad. Because the people that we know and love, we can't always see them anymore. We can't talk to them like we used to. But they're always a part of us. And they see us. And they love us. And they care for us. Let us pray. Dear Lord, death is never easy to understand for adults or for children. But help us to see that in your love, our spirits are freed from the shackles and the chains that bind us, free from sin and free from suffering. Give us grace for those who mourn and for those we miss. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Our scripture lesson for today comes from 1 Corinthians, verses 51, and I'll be reading today through verse 57. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled: death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your sting? Where, O death, is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. May God bless the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of this, the holy word of our Lord. Let us pray. My Lord, what a morning. That Easter morning so long ago and as new as yesterday, when through the power and love of God, death was defeated through the empty tomb of our Savior. In these days, O God, we pray that we may find strength and hope for the living of the days in which we live. These things we ask in your name, O Lord, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. There are several home remedies suggested for bee or wasp stings. Some suggest a drop of honey. Others suggest meat tenderizer or a paste made of baking soda. Apple cider vinegar is an option as well. Surprisingly, toothpaste is listed as a remedy to relieve the pain of bee sting. We are accustomed to the stings of yellow jackets, bees, hornets, and wasps. And now, on top of everything else in 2020 that has happened, there is news about the murder hornets that have come this way from Asia to the continental United States. Hornet stings are bad enough, but apparently the sting of a murder hornet is like having a piece of red-hot metal applied to your skin and the nerves beneath. A new kind of sting that may need a new kind of remedy. Paul talks to the Corinthians about a kind of sting, not from an insect, but from the sting of death. The Corinthians faced division and persecution, and they were starting to wrestle with their understandings of life and death and resurrection and whether it all meant something. For most of chapter 15, Paul answers with logic and passion and urged them to remember what Jesus had done, as many of them had heard just a few years earlier, what he had done on the cross and of the empty tomb. Paul soothed the sting with the eternal remedy of the resurrection that answers the doubts and the fears of the Corinthians and for all the generations since. But in this season of life, in 2020 and the COVID crisis, we are finding that death has found a new sting. Surely that has happened through the thousands of deaths from the virus and the havoc it plays on the human body. But there's also a new sting for our souls as the ripples of consequence of COVID-19 wash over the world and wash over us. It is a sting to the soul that we see our friends and loved ones afflicted with COVID, as well as those with other medical conditions, have to lie alone in the hospital, isolated from family and friends. We can only imagine what it is like for a patient already burdened with sickness to face those issues alone, even as families huddle around a single cell phone or a computer screen to see and talk to a loved one from a distance. It is a sting of the soul when people die in the hospital alone, beyond the touch of loved ones, with only the eyes of medical personnel to watch life's last breath. Medical personnel who have seen too many deaths, too many of these deaths in too short a time. Medical personnel are stung as well. It is a sting of the soul as members of a family look through a nursing home window to see loved ones who may not see them waving through the glass. Those in the rooms do not understand why family cannot come close, and it is stinging anguish. And it is agony for those beyond the glass not to come close and offer a soothing, healing touch. It is a sting to the soul for a restricted few to gather for a graveside service of a beloved family member and to be socially distanced from each other, and to be socially distanced from their church. We grieve alone. We are deprived of the comforting care and touch of friends. It is a sting to the soul for members of a church to read of the death of a fellow member in the newspaper and see where the graveside service is private. It stings not to be able to extend compassion to the grieving or to comfort one another in our time of loss. It stings to have fleeting thoughts that flash across our minds that we desperately want to avoid. Passing thoughts about the worst thing we believe can happen. That through our own personal ignorance or negligence, a loved one, parent, a spouse, or a child should catch this deadly virus. What if they die? The sting of death is unusually strong these days. How are we to live with our fear? What is the remedy that lessens the power of this sting of death? Where is our healing and hope? For me, the remedy for the sting of death comes from the first words I offer at every committal service I have done. Will continue to do. From the first one for Mr. Harold Carlisle in the first funeral that I ever did in 1990 to Mr. Sam Anderson this afternoon. After the family is seated and the friends are gathered somewhere nearby, there is a moment of uncomfortable silence as the funeral home director gives me the nod. And I open with these words. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. Then comes the rest of Paul's strong and comforting words that make up this morning's scripture reading. For Paul and for the seeking faithful, it starts with the mystery of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are given the victory of eternal life through Christ by the mercy of God. And Paul speaks of that change in the blink of an eye and putting on immortality and imperishability. Paul doesn't offer scientific theories or mathematical proofs. He offers mystery. For centuries, we have tried to solve the mystery, and thereby have some mastery over the ingredients of the remedy. Theologians debate and the faithful wonder about what happens when we die and how it happens when we rise. But all of the truths and all of the answers will not take away the sting of grief and the sting of death. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. Our lives, our loneliness, our fear, our anguish, and yes, even our death matter to God. We do not die alone. Even when we are isolated and cut off from family and friends, the loving presence of God is there in quiet but mysterious ways. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. In the words of Jesus from the Sermon on the Mount, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. The presence of God consoles us in sure but in mysterious ways. Is it any wonder that Christ told the anxious disciples in the upper room, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Beyond what we can explain, there is the peace that surpasses all understanding. Listen. And I will tell you a mystery that comes from the book of 1 John. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. The remedy for the sting of death. In the first century in the town of Corinth, and in the 21st century in the town of Sumter, the remedy for the sting of death is found in the mystery and the power and the love of God. Where, O death, is your sting? Where, O death, is your victory? God is our remedy for the sting of death. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, as a response to the word of God proclaimed among us, I invite you to stand and offer as you can the affirmation of faith with your lips and with your heart as we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please make yourself comfortable. This morning in our prayer concerns, we lift to our church family and to the world the faithfulness of Mr. Sam Anderson. Mr. Sam died overnight this past Wednesday night into Thursday morning on his birthday. 97 years old. He died peacefully in his sleep. And we are thankful for the life and the witness that he has given God through his life, through his work, through his time at Trinity United Methodist Church. We are also in a time when, within our own country, where we are rushing to come back, rushing to be back to normal. And as badly as we want everything to be like it was, it will never be like it was again. Even when we open the doors, there will be reluctance of people. Know that for this church family here at Trinity, we know that there are those who would love it if we opened the doors today and let you in. And we know that there are those among us who would not be comfortable until the end of July. I invite you to please pray for your leaders as we seek to find a path of health and safety that prolongs life and ensures health as best we can. There are other concerns within the life of our world. The unemployment rate of our state and our community. Thankfully, I was able to get my hair cut yesterday, and I was talking to the person who cut my hair, and I asked her, "How did it go for you?" She said that they had closed 2 months ago, and I said, "Were you able to find unemployment?" "No, I was not." There are those within our community, people that we see on our streets, whose faces may smile, but whose inner soul is hurting. May we remember the life of our community and the people in it. At this time, I invite you to spend a few quiet moments before the throne of grace of Almighty God as we hear this instrumental call to prayer. O God of the resurrection, this day we rejoice because our Lord defeated death. He was the first fruits, the firstborn of the resurrection. Lord God, in the busyness of our lives, in the time away from Sunday morning scripture readings, in the time of reading the obituaries, in our time of hearing news, in our time of living life, help us, O God. Take away the sting of death. Relieve us of our worry and anxiety. And equip us to be yours in this kingdom, your kingdom. Forgive us of our sins and shortcomings, for the times that we have not been obedient to your word and to your way. Free us now for joyful obedience in your kingdom. These things we ask in your name. Amen. This morning, as we come to our time of reflection upon the gifts of God, I want to say thank you again for those of you that are giving to the ministries of Trinity United Methodist Church. Thank you for your tithes and offerings and making sure they are getting here even when you cannot come. You have made it possible for us to continue our ministries. You've made it possible for us to make a difference in the lives of people. And we thank you for them, and we encourage you to continue to find ways to give. We understand, my friends, those that may be having a hard time financially right now. And certainly we do not expect you that are jobless, those of you that are facing diminished hours, certainly we do not expect you to give in the ways that you have in the past. Our hearts and our souls and our prayers are extended to you. In this time together, as we reflect on the gifts of God, let us give thanks for the world that comes in the beauty of a blue sky, in the gentleness of a breeze, and the laughter of a child, and a smash cake at an 18th birthday. There is so much in our lives to be thankful for. Let us go to the Lord and thank God for God's abundant gifts. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of life, for that which moves within us, that gives us the ability to breathe, to serve, to do all of those things. But this day, O Lord, on this Memorial Day weekend, we are mindful of those who gave a sacrifice of their lives for the cause of freedom. We pray, O Lord, that on this special weekend, you will guide us not with thoughts of picnics, but also, O God, may we have thoughts of those who have come before us, family members, friends, and ancestors. Take now, O Lord, the gifts that we offer you, of our lives, of our talents, and our gifts, and may they all be used to further your kingdom on this world and forevermore. Amen. Now, go. Go with courage. Go with God. Go with love. And go with God. Go, and may the path that you walk be free of grief, free of anxiety. And may you know the truth and the mystery of resurrection. Amen.